Mr. Speaker, I rise to throw my support behind this appropriation bill. But before I explain why, Mr. Deputy Speaker, please grant me leave once again to thank the people of Groseley for bestowing their confidence in me as a parliamentary representative. They've seen the stark difference in the modus operandi of those who were born on Mary Terrace Street, but are on different sides of the political aisle. And they've realized that they should watch and look in one particular direction, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the people have been patient with me, and they are fully aware that I continue to work hard for them daily. Mr. Speaker, please grant me leave to congratulate publicly Julian Alfred for yet again breaking our sprint records, Mr. Speaker. Alfred is putting the rest of the world on notice that St. Lucia is here.
Yes, sir.
And that sports development is on the right track in the simply beautiful island of St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, allow me to congratulate our Karifta track and field team, who achieved the historic landmark of 8 medals at the 50th edition of the championship. Allow me to also congratulate the Karifta swim team on the medal tally at the swimming version of this annual event. The swimmers continue to toil against the region's best as they wait patiently for their 50-meter pool. In addition to this, our women continue to make us proud in the sport of cricket. St. Lucia emerged champions of the Windward Islands 50-over tournament, and they finished second in the T20 version, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, our under-19 male team, featuring one Sonny Ledward, dominated this year's competition, Mr. Speaker. And we know he's supposed to be on that Windward Islands team, and we'll do what we have to do, because we know the talent resides in the people of St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I can revert to so many of our achievements in the past 2 months, Mr. Speaker. DeAndre Caldron, second place finish, Caribbean Table Tennis Tournament, Mr. Speaker. Top two in the region, Mr. Speaker. 6 St. Lucians, Mr. Deputy Speaker, qualified for a global event in the sport of chess. 6, Mr. Speaker. And yet, some would stand and posture and say nothing is going on in the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, after 5+ years of being in a horrible relationship, Fair Helen decided to break up with her abusive partner. In 2021,
with a corrupt partner,
Helen as a woman was beaten, battered, bruised. And when she thought she would have been free after 5 years, they battered her for months on end, Mr. Speaker.
That you are King signatories.
Noose after noose was placed around her neck. Tuesday after Tuesday, they borrowed and borrowed to drown and suffocate Helen, Mr. Speaker.
When they didn't borrow, they gave away.
More and more.
And they gave away.
Alas, Mr. Speaker, Fair Helen got to a comatose state, but she was placed in a hospital, Mr. Speaker. But Mr. Speaker, on July 26, 2021, in came a team of doctors from the St. Lucia Labour Party.
And out went the bankers.
Coupled with a medical genius from Castries North.
That's right.
And a trauma surgeon from Castries Central. Mr. Speaker, the most critical component of that medical team is the chief of surgery from Castries East, Mr. Speaker. This is a man with over 25 years of experience. He is seasoned, well-educated, and most of all, Mr. Speaker, he studied at an institution close enough to Fair Helen which placed him in a position of empathy, far superior to a former abuser whose Canada education proved insufficient, Mr. Speaker.
Oh my God, she's
mad. Mr. Speaker,
futile.
Could you imagine the ones who caused so much damage to Fair Helen? They were busy taking the vehicle away from the brilliant deputy chief of surgery from Castries South, in an attempt to prevent him from coming to do the additional work that Helen needs, Mr. Speaker. But Mr. Speaker, as we heard from the chief of surgery, the surgeon from Castries South pushed on, and his hair bringing in the blood of life, the medicine called tourism, back into the blood, the veins of Helen, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, we continue to see the progress being made finally by Helen. Also a critical part of this team is the fluent, stylistic but aggressive heart surgeon from the constituency of Labrie, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this heart surgeon has traveled near and far to negotiate health aid from Taiwan to Venezuela, from Cuba to Serbia, to bring in as much aid to Helen, Mr. Speaker. Now, Mr. Speaker, when someone has been abused as Helen was, and has debt to the tune of $4 billion, the open wounds are very painful to cure, Mr. Speaker. The sores yield great pains and stings when the necessary balms and medication are applied. Sometimes, Mr. Speaker, the great doctor has no choice but to apply even more pressure to produce great relief in the future. And so, Mr. Speaker, when the chief of surgery from Castries East, along with the other doctors selected for the great recovery, began their work, Mr. Speaker, more and more issues reared their ugly heads, which undoubtedly, Mr. Speaker, provided setbacks on our way to recovery. The disease of direct awards, DFCs came in for immediate financial payments. Yeah. Don't remember. It lessened the chief's ability to provide better roads on our way to recovery. And so the team had to settle with the patching and patching of deep holes embedded over Fair Helen on the way to this great recovery. Could you imagine, Mr. Speaker, that not even the hospital, which is critical to Helen's health, was given the tools for her survival, Mr. Speaker? In fact, they played foolish games with it and failed to give a brother up north called Owen King any attention until crisis hit, Mr. Speaker. But Mr. Speaker, while this medical team is at work day and night, hour after hour on Helen, her previous abusers, they are busy criticizing the progress and blaming the new team for not being able to do more to give Fair Helen all that she needs while we are working on making her better, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I listened to the chief of surgery diagnose and explain the medical procedures he intends to undertake to make Helen better. And in his diagnosis, he spoke about revenue. Because we know, Mr. Speaker, and we see the posturing, Helen or any individual, any country, cannot survive without revenue. That's right. You cannot prosper without revenue. You cannot criticize on the one hand and say you need to do A, B, and C to curb crime, but say, don't have any levies. You cannot say, let's do this about our medical situation, but don't bring revenue to our country. And so, Mr. Speaker, we see with class how this chief of surgery is going to ensure that revenue is brought into this nation without suffocating Fair Helen, Mr. Speaker. So the chief of surgery understands that Helen needs food. And so no levy is placed on food and groceries in St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the chief of surgery indicated that we need health care and that Helen needs to be healthier. And so there's a levy on cigarettes, which we know is not good for Helen, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we know at the end of the day that proper shelter is needed for Helen. And so, Mr. Speaker, we've removed the VAT, Mr. Speaker, on cement, Mr. Speaker, on plywood, Mr. Speaker, those things that we know Helen needs to provide shelter for her and her children, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, I have no issue with supporting the Minister of Finance and the Member for Castries East in his quest to provide a better way for Helen, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the member for Miku South said during the budget debate that all we do is travel. And he said again, Mr. Speaker, that nothing is going on. And it's enhanced. He even said that nothing is going on in the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports. Can you believe this, Mr. Speaker? He even had the audacity, the temerity, the unmitigated gall to bring up Julian Alfred, Mr. Speaker, in this honorable house. Mr. Speaker, do you know that some of the travel during this last financial year was to ensure that athletes such as Julian Alfred can continue to flourish, can do what she needs to do untamed, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, when we came in, a governing body called WADA, World Anti-Doping Agency, it requires every nation with Olympic athletes, with athletes that are desirous of representing the country, to make contributions to ensure that the anti-doping laws and regulations meet the international standards. And when we came in government, Mr. Speaker, there was a huge concern that enough was not done in this regard. And so, when WADA called, a very important appointment was made in Jamaica to ensure that St. Lucia was in compliance with those rules, Mr. Speaker. And so we see, Mr. Speaker, that finally, that we have a committee set up in St. Lucia that will allow that everything we need to do as it applies to anti-doping is followed to the T. When this is not done, Mr. Speaker, at any point in time, you can be sanctioned. We know some of what has happened in the more developed countries in terms of doping, and we will never, as a ministry, allow for St. Lucia to not be in compliance. And so we've done everything we've had to do to ensure that we are doing the justice that our athletes need. Mr. Speaker, we have decided as a ministry that part of our mandate is to reach young people where they are. And so, Mr. Speaker, we have decided that we are going to have an alternative sports desk at our ministry. Mr. Speaker, not every young person in St. Lucia can kick a ball and run fast and shoot a basket. And so, Mr. Speaker, in order for us to touch those that are involved in other activities that are considered physical, we ensured that we employed Craig Gustav, Mr. Speaker, whose mandate was to reach these young individuals, find out what their interests are, and provide programming for them, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, we see in with this alternative sports desk the development of chess, Mr. Speaker. We see in motocross, Mr. Speaker, and all of those activities being given attention finally in this country, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, as I said earlier, scores of young people participated in a national test tournament in the community of Grozily. We had individuals from all walks of life, Mr. Speaker. More than 100 young people participating in this competition. And so we saw six of them reaching the threshold, and they are currently in Venezuela participating in this competition, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, motocross, video games, darts, the likes throughout the year, Mr. Speaker, we will be developing it, but we've decided that we are going to have an alternative sports season. And so between December 13th and February 22nd, this is the ideal time where we see a structure for those competitions, Mr. Speaker. And for the first time this year, Mr. Speaker, having this season, we saw more than 300 individuals from across the region descending on St. Lucia to take part in this tournament, Mr. Speaker. And so the bikers enjoyed some good times in Sufre, a very nice competition organized, and you could see some of the photos, beaming with pride as they received their medals, Mr. Speaker. Finally getting some recognition, Mr. Speaker, and we saw the talent, Mr. Speaker, and we're going to continue to nurture that. Mr. Speaker, one of the alternative opportunities we identified was the development of beach football in St. Lucia. And so, Mr. Speaker, we saw in early April the first steps towards this development. We had the Northern Beach Football Tournament, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the young people, they came out and they enjoyed football in the sand. We are surrounded by beaches and water, Mr. Speaker. A few years ago, we came out on top at the Commonwealth Junior level in beach football. And since then, not enough has been done. So, Speaker, the games were highly competitive. New generation from the community of Babono came out on top. And so I know Grozily, Castries, and all the others up north, we'll be looking to do something, considering Babono doesn't even have a beach. And so we're looking to spread on the west coast, the east coast, and in the south, Mr. Speaker. Mark, we stand. Speaking of football, the Ministry of Sports continues to collaborate with the St. Lucia Football Association and the Youth Economy Agency for the establishment of the semi-professional league in St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. The association has been putting together the technical and legal framework for our footballers to be placed in the dynamics that allows for them to be bought and sold locally, regionally, and internationally. This league is expected to set the path for greater financial gains by our clubs in St. Lucia. And so, Mr. Speaker, when they say nothing is going on with the youth, you have to wonder. This opens the door for young people interested in photography. Set up your online agency. Come to the playing fields. Get persons to advertise on your website. This provides the opportunities for physiotherapists, Mr. Speaker. Videographers, Mr. Speaker. Get involved in digital marketing, Mr. Speaker. And of course, the coaches and those involved in health and fitness can also benefit from this activity, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I remember for a number of years, I played football in Grozily and of course all over St. Lucia and in the region, and never got 25 cents for all my efforts. Finally, a young person in the communities can say, I am going to be a professional footballer, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we've developed all of those activities in collaboration with the St. Lucia Football Association, Mr. Speaker. We are doing all of this to develop the most popular sport in St. Lucia. Yet, Mr. Speaker, a member for Miku South and his surrogates, you take to social media to falsely tell the people of St. Lucia that I used taxpayers' monies, or that I requested taxpayers' monies to attend the FIFA World Cup in Qatar, Mr. Speaker.
Ably assisted by Bradley.
Mr. Speaker, again, they traveled and traveled, but for them, a young minister, a little boy from what would they considered from Maritere Street, running around in his calzone, Bay Street, playing hide and seek under the cocoa pear. That young man cannot possibly be invited by FIFA to watch a World Cup, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, a young man who is working assiduously to bring British football up, Mr. Speaker, he cannot be invited, Mr. Speaker. So, Mr. Speaker, I'm left with no choice but to set the record straight, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, United Park. Let's start with the United Workers Party page. And I'm going to read some of the posts that was placed in plain sight, tarnishing my name. Information reaching us from some disgruntled officials within the Ministry of Sports is that an allocation of over $50,000 had been requested by Minister Kenson Casimir to cover a five-day trip to Qatar to witness the finals of a FIFA World Cup. United Workers Party. United Park, St. Lucia. There seem to be more questions than answers in this Casimir FIFA saga. We must note that the most common FIFA email format is xsofiazul.org. Does FIFA ever communicate with the government organization regarding FIFA events, or do they go through the Football Association? We are now in communication with FIFA officials to ascertain the authenticity of documents.
Lies and more lies. Lies.
United Park, St. Lucia. At a time when St. Lucians are reeling from incidents of crime and high food and fuel prices, we have been informed that the Minister of Sports intends to travel to Qatar, taxpayers' money.
Saga
scandal. The Kenson Casimir FIFA saga.
Minus scandal.
Is Kenson Casimir the most fortunate minister of sports in the Caribbean to be awarded a ticket to Qatar by FIFA? For the records, FIFA always pay for lodging, etc. When issuing tickets, Kenson was handed a ticket by the St. Lucia Football Association and he received a top-up from the NLA. All this was done in the name of politics. St. Lucia Football Association is very political. It goes on to say that the FA is killing our local football.
Who knows me?
Is Kenson Casimir the most fortunate minister of sports in the Caribbean? And I think he sees the name and he wants me to say it. But there are lots of court proceedings. So I just want to be very strategic, Mr. Speaker. This is what they peddled. Because a young man
peddling,
who is working assiduously with FIFA, cannot be invited to watch the FIFA World Cup, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, I'm left to ensure that I get the official document from FIFA. And today, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to make this a document of the House. FIFA World Cup Qatar 2022. Invitation. Honorable Kenson J. Casimir, Minister of Youth Development and Sports of St. Lucia, Zurich, 12 December. You know it's J, that's the middle name. 12 December 2022. Invitation to the FIFA World Cup Qatar 2022. FIFA. Dear Mr. Casimir, from November 20th to 18th December 2022, the eyes of the entire world will be on Qatar, the host of the 22nd FIFA World Cup, and it is my great pleasure to invite you as a guest of honor to the first ever FIFA World Cup Games, FIFA World Cup organized in the Middle East. I would be honored to share this exciting adventure with you, all while enjoying the warm Qatari hospitality and savoring the color, passion, and emotion that will be on display throughout the whole tournament. I would be grateful if you could confirm your attendance for any match of your choice by email to president@fifa.org. My office remains at your entire disposal for any need. Looking forward to welcoming you to Qatar, I take this opportunity to thank you once again, dear Minister, for your contribution to the development of football and the promotion of the values of the sport in your country. Yours sincerely, Gianni Infantino.
You know,
Gianni Infantino. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I would like for this to be made a document of the House, Mr. Speaker. Make this a document of the House because, Mr. Speaker, sometimes you just have to put yourself out there. Here is the opportunity. Contact FIFA. Some of them like to travel. Travel to Zurich. Do any investigation that you need to and find out if this was not sent by FIFA. Is Kenson the most fortunate minister of sports in the Caribbean to be awarded a ticket to FIFA? I say to them, Kenson may be one of the hardest working sports ministers in the Caribbean. And so, when you know you invest your time, you invest who you are, you cannot let them sully your name. And so, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to read another email sent to my secretary because they said I requested $50,000. We look forward to welcoming the Honorable Kenson Casimir to the final of the FIFA World Cup. FIFA would be happy to organize flights and accommodation for Mr. Casimir. May I kindly ask you to share his preferred travel dates and route so we may propose options. In addition, we'd be happy to assist him with his higher applications. We'd kindly need his passport, copy of his ID, and everything. We'll organize transfers from the airport to the matches. Mr. Speaker, all covered by FIFA.
Documentary evidence, you call that, my boy.
So, Mr. Speaker, the member for Miku South also said that nothing was going on in the Ministry of Sports, Mr. Speaker. Nothing was happening with the youth. And so, I have to sometimes wonder if he pays attention to what's going on or if he has selective amnesia. By the way, Hansard would have it today that I have officially filed legal documents against those who have tried to tarnish my reputation. So, Mr. Speaker, when I assumed the position of Youth and Sports Minister, I was ready to take youth and sports development in this nation to another level. And I still feel that way, Mr. Speaker. As you may know, the financing of youth and sports development comes primarily from activities of the St. Lucia National Lotteries Authorities. And Mr. Speaker, we've had challenges. Most of the challenges created by my predecessor. And so, Mr. Speaker, very soon, once I get the go-ahead and the all clear from the Attorney General, due to the fact that we have some legal proceedings, I'll be making some other pronouncements, Mr. Speaker. But when I came in, zero financial reports were done by the entity of the St. Lucia National Lotteries. In fact, the last time it was done, I will have you all guess. The last time it was done, or we saw any evidence, it was when the member for Denbury North was in charge, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, at the last debate, the member for Biku South said that the finances or the revenue from the National Lotteries Authority, he is hearing somewhere that it is low. When I rose on a point of order, a point of clarity, would not allow me to speak. But today I will speak, Mr. Speaker. Today I will definitely speak. Mr. Speaker, the ministry went through some challenging times, Mr. Speaker. One of the major challenges was the poor state of the island's sporting facilities. It is quite obvious that if we are going to develop a semi-pro league or sports, we need facilities. And so, Mr. Speaker, we had to ensure that the use of renewable energy became part of our overall youth and sports development thrust. Therefore, we have embarked on a systematic approach to the rehabilitation of sporting infrastructure in St. Lucia. During the financial year 2022-2023, we have undertaken works at the Sufre Mini Stadium, lighting and structural upgrades to the VG Sports Complex, structural upgrades to Cicero Playing Field, lights at the Otabo Court, the Deramo Court, Mr. Speaker, Saab Playing Field, Goodlands Court, the Larissus Denry Playing Field. We started some work there just before Black Hat last year. The Corinth Playing Field and the Groslay Playing Field Change Room. Mr. Speaker, in the new financial year, we'll undertake works on several other sporting facilities. But unlike our predecessors, who irresponsibly invested in plastic fields, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we've decided to be environmentally friendly, Mr. Speaker, for sports development. And so we've initiated our renewable energy in sports program. So in terms of lighting, we've seen the huge cost of electricity bills. And so, Mr. Speaker, we've piloted the first ever 100% off the grid field lighting facility in the region, in the community of Corinth, Mr. Speaker. Corinth, I can say, will be the first 100% solar lit playing field, Mr. Speaker. Off the grid.
Next is Marshall.
Corinth. Corinth.
Next is Marshall.
As such, Mr. Speaker, the lights could be on from 7 p.m. and until 12 or 1 without a single cost to the community. Of course, during the pilot, we have seen the implementation cost, of course, originally would be up, but a lifespan of over 20 years before you needing to change a battery is well worth it, Mr. Speaker. Savings over time. In addition to this, Mr. Speaker, the Corinth Secondary School, they will enjoy the fact that their classrooms could be solar powered, Mr. Speaker. And so, we have a number of playing fields. At the school, the roof of the school could be used to place the panels, and the playing field could be lit. And so we are killing two birds with one stone. One stone. And so, Mr. Speaker, quite apart from what was done, we are showing that we are more environmentally friendly, Mr. Speaker. As such, we will continue with this program at other venues through a phased approach. First installing the LED lights at the facilities and then adding the solar panels to ensure we benefit from the same. Some of the facilities include Bellevue, Marigold, Philip Marseille Grounds, Mindo Philip Park, Gardens, Library Playing Field, the Wen Playing Field. Where's Jeremiah with his smiles? The Wen Playing Field, Mr. Speaker. Grand Ravine Playing Field, I've understood that the minister, the member, has already started the process to ensure that the poles are on island, and so NLA will ensure that it's LED, and then transition 100% solar, Mr. Speaker. This is the direction, this is the vision of this government, Mr. Speaker. I know it's solar you want. So, Mr. Speaker, We continue to show a stark contrast in what we do. And so, one of the biggest projects we will be undertaking is the National Aquatic Center in Groseley. Mr. Speaker, we've had administrative after administrative setbacks, Mr. Speaker. And when you have an activity or project of this magnitude, you want to ensure that you get it right and you do it responsibly. So we've taken every precaution, and shortly after budget, we will finally be seeing the commencement of the works, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, it is one thing to invest in sporting infrastructure, but another thing to manage and maintain it. In this regard, we have adopted a comprehensive policy on the management of sports facilities, which will guide the administration of our sporting infrastructure. The policy has been adopted and passed. It's expected that all associations and affiliates and even parliamentary reps could understand what is needed for the upgrade of the playing field to regional and international standards, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, we are continuing to look at the activities of the George Odlum Stadium, and we expect that when we finally move into the new St. Jude's, Mr. Speaker, that George Odlum will get the attention that it deserves, Mr. Speaker. So in addition to providing and maintaining facilities, the growth of the nation's athletes depends on the strength and the availability of programs. And so we continue to encourage associations to focus on grassroots programs from the primary and the infant schools, Mr. Speaker. So we've identified the Stuart Charles and Earl Borlaug Jean under the Emerging Athletes Program to identify some of our emerging athletes to place them in a program, Mr. Speaker. So we will see the rip and we'll reap the benefits going forward, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, of critical focus and success for the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports was the reintroduction of school sports, Mr. Speaker. Yes. We saw under 15 cricket tournaments, Mr. Speaker. We saw netball, we saw volleyball, Mr. Speaker. We saw basketball. And so, Mr. Speaker, we continue to work with the Ministry of Education to ensure that we continue to develop school sports. Mr. Speaker, it was very heartening to see the passion and the excitement displayed by all participants and some parents. And Mr. Speaker, we continue to encourage them to come out. And so, we as a government decided that this year we'd be hosting the rebranded Island Champs, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, there is a reason why most other nations have gravitated towards having school sports on the weekend. It allows some of the scouts from overseas to come and spend a weekend, enjoy the sun and sea while taking in some of our athletes. There are countless benefits. Parents could attend. Coaches from all over could attend. The support from communities are heightened. And so this year, while it happened on a Friday, we continue to have discourse and engagement with the Ministry of Education, the teachers, the principals, the PE folks, and the coaches to ensure that we can host the Island Champs next year on the weekend, Mr. Speaker. Viewfort Comprehensive, they came out on top of this year's competition. And somebody said, as usual, they had not done it for a little while, but they dominated this year. And we identified the prize money for the school who won. And this is also under review for next year's competition. And so we require more and more stakeholders to come on board as we move in this direction, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I now turn my attention to the ministry's coaching program. It's a very vibrant coaching unit. 21 coaches in the fields of table tennis, boxing, cricket, football, volleyball, netball, and track and field, Mr. Speaker. I must note that last year we were able to secure the services of 2 Cuban coaches, one for track and field, one for boxing. The focus in the new year will be on strengthening the capacity of coaches to produce even better quality athletes. Mr. Speaker, the sport of boxing will be given particular attention this year. The sport launched its Hands in Glove not on guns program down south, and it has reaped huge benefits for all of us, Mr. Speaker. Hands in gloves, not on guns. Mr. Speaker, over 50 boxers from the communities in Viewfort South are part of this program. And they continue to span through different schools to get them on board so that we can teach conflict resolution, self-control, anger management through sport, Mr. Speaker. So we continue to see and reap those benefits, Mr. Speaker. As recently, we had the Caribbean Boxing Championships at the VG Multipurpose Court. The champions of champions and St. Lucia came out on top, Mr. Speaker. So we're seeing, Mr. Speaker, great strides in the sport of boxing. Mr. Speaker, the Ministry's Elite and Emerging Athlete Program continues to provide much-needed support to talented student athletes. Mr. Speaker, one of the first things I did when I became Minister of Sport was to identify some of the best athletes on the island. And as Minister, I made it my duty to visit these athletes, visit their homes, meet with their parents, visit their schools, speak with their coaches, find out from their family what their situation is, Mr. Speaker. And some of these athletes, Mr. Speaker, we recommended counseling, we recommended nutritional allowances, transportation allowances, we provided psychosocial support, Mr. Speaker, to them and their families. Mr. Speaker, I will not announce here who some of these athletes are. But I can tell you, Mr. Speaker, that despite some of the challenges in getting those resources to them, we've seen them perform at high levels, and we've seen them bring back medals to this great nation. And so, Mr. Speaker, and somebody postures and says nothing is going on in youth development and sports, you have to wonder what's going on. During the last year, this program supported a total of 44 athletes to the tune of $252,265.55, an average of $5,700 per athlete, Mr. Speaker. This year, Mr. Speaker, we have placed in the budget an amount to ensure the successful transition of Julian Alfred to a professional athlete. And of course, we all know how important that support is, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we will have other individuals make their pronouncements. The Minister of Finance announced that Julian Alfred has finally been given a diplomatic passport by the government of St. Lucia. It was necessary, Mr. Speaker. And I will allow the other individuals to make the announcements as it relates to Julian Alfred, Mr. Speaker. But we have to be careful. And this government took every precaution. We consulted with the NCAA to ensure that we were not in infringement of any of their rules. We spoke with a coach. We spoke with our parents, Mr. Speaker, to ensure that we were doing the right thing, Mr. Speaker. And of course, we had to ensure that any pronouncement that we make did not affect her, Mr. Speaker. And so, in a month and a half, she will be transitioning from a collegiate athlete to a professional athlete. And so, vision of the Minister of Finance was there to ensure that we place a budget for this effective transition, Mr. Speaker. And so, she will not necessarily have to go and find a job. We'll provide the support when she finally gets there, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I must provide clarity sometimes on the policy of this government as it pertains to sport and youth development because of some of what the surrogates say, Mr. Speaker. While they may not want to believe, or they may want people to believe that the SLP government is no different from them, I would like to make it clear that these two governments are like chalk and cheese. Mr. Speaker, the St. Lucia Labour Party is a government that is compassionate and a government that pays their bills, Mr. Speaker. Whether the person providing the invoice is Labour or Flobo, whether the project was ill-conceived, like choosing artificial turf over grass. When we come in government, we clear our bills and we get brutalized for it. Because instead of taking the finances and forgetting about the bills that were absorbed in times past, instead of doing what we need to do, we stop and we clear our bills, Mr. Speaker. That is our modus operandi. But Mr. Speaker, it is really sad when someone from overseas is given a contract. They come to our country, they use our people's services, and they do not pay them, Mr. Speaker. They use small, medium-sized businesses, resources, and do not pay them. Mr. Speaker, I was saddened by a letter and a bill that came to me. Mr. Speaker, this bill was for taxi services rendered to Mr. Don Lockerbie for travel on the island of St. Lucia. Bills that I later found out he was supposed to have paid, but did not, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, when we came in, the individual who has a small business, who has to keep his business going, Mr. Speaker, cannot get into contact with this gentleman. And Mr. Speaker had no choice but to pen a letter to the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports.
Lockerbie should be at Bordeaux.
October 25th, 2022. Mr. Speaker, during the member for Mikusau's presentation on the budget, he had the audacity to say that the finances are low at the national lotteries, Mr. Speaker. When we have to use the national lotteries to pay some of their bills, Mr. Speaker. And so, and the member for Castries Southeast insists, I need Bexo. And the member for Viewfort South has a beautiful program he wants to implement at the Binful Secondary. And he comes to me and I say, the revenue is not there quite yet. It is because we have to take care of bills that we inherit, Mr. Speaker. Some of the times. October 25th, 2022, Honorable Kenson Casimir, Parliamentary Representative for Grozile and Minister for Sports. Dear Honorable Casimir, I write to officially request that monies owed to my company by Mr. Don Lockerbie be made available to me by the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports. As you may know, my company was contracted during the period of 2017 to 2019 to provide taxi services to Mr. Lockerbie during his time spent in executing St. Lucia's National Sports Infrastructure Program. Since the completion of this program, I have found it difficult to obtain payment from Mr. Lockerbie, who is no longer in St. Lucia. I appeal to your good conscience as the Member of Parliament for our constituency of Grozile and the Minister for Sports to intervene on my behalf. Please see attached agreement for services and the outstanding
Member
invoices. Any
Member
courtesies?
Grozile, you have 10 minutes left. Member for Castries Central.
Mr. Deputy, I wish to invoke Standing Order Number 328 to allow the member for Grozile an extra 30 minutes to complete his presentation.
Members, the question is that Standing Order 4210 be invoked and that the member for Grozile be granted an additional 30 minutes to conclude his presentation. And I'll put the question, as many have this opinion, say aye.
Aye.
As many have the contrary opinion, say no. Ayes have it. I think the ayes have it. Continue, member for Grozile.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, colleagues. And so, Mr. Speaker, we did our due diligence. We had to make sure that what was being said was true. And so the invoices along with the contract was brought to the ministry. Invoice 007, July 2019. UNO International Airport to Harbor Club, $150. Harbor Club took ash trees and returned full day, $350. Harbor Club to UNO International, $150. Grand total, $1,952 for services of transporting Mr. Lockerbie around St. Lucia to put artificial turf. August 2019, this invoice, VG to Soufre, Viewfort to Grosley, Viewfort to Soufre, Grosley full day, Harbor Club to Viewfort, another $7,800. October 2019, October 15th, UNO International Airport, George F. L. Charles to George F. L. Charles Airport, Harbor Club to Grosley, Harbor Club to Soufre, Soufre to UNO International, $3,600. October 31st, 2019, where were we in 2019 before?
Not close.
I was still at NBC.
Me too.
UNO International to Grosley, Harbor Club, another $3,000. December 30th, 2019, Harbor Club to UNO International Airport, UNO International Airport to Harbor Club, Harbor Club to Grosley, and return, the list goes on, $7,800.
Tell them that's US, eh?
UNO International Airport to Harbor Club, no. Yes, UNO International Airport to Harbor Club, Harbor Club to Grosley, go through the list, $11,564, that's East. To transfer Mr. Don Lockerbie in the execution of the National Sports Infrastructure Project. Mr. Speaker, we had to come up with the financing to ensure this gentleman, who has a small business, who needs his finances to pay for his family, to do basic things, Mr. Speaker, to ensure that he's compensated.
So he got paid.
And so, as a government, once we saw the contract had been signed, once we got the invoices, once we saw what was not paid, what we saw was that we needed to compensate this individual. And so we did. Mr. Speaker, we never asked what this person's political affiliation was. As a matter of fact, some persons believe that this person is of a political persuasion that may not be mine. But Mr. Speaker, once the work is done and there is confirmation, we will try our best to ensure that it is paid, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this is the same government, Mr. Speaker, who is questioning and saying that finances are low, who gave $300,000, Mr. Speaker. They paid $300,000 for medals during COVID-19, Mr. Speaker. For school sports competitions during COVID-19, Mr. Speaker. COVID medals, you call it. And the minister has the temerity, the member has the temerity to say that he's hearing that finances are low, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, there's another one, eh? There's another one. Scott Sports Shop and Awards. 22nd of October 2019, Mr. Speaker. $56,000 owed, Mr. Speaker, since 2019, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, when we came in, we decided that after 3 years, another medium-sized, I'm not even sure we can call that a medium-sized business. It's a small business. With people being employed, we had to ensure that we took care of that, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, there was more, you know, more invoices that we inherited. The pool, Mr. Speaker, the pool was docked in Italy when we came in. And already we were getting requests for payments of close to $30,000 a month because of an agreement that was signed. So we said, you know what? We're going to pray to bring our pools down in St. Lucia, and then we're going to store it here for cheaper, Mr. Speaker. Purchase orders, Mr. Speaker, and many more, Mr. Speaker. The lawnmower? I haven't seen that one. I'll look for it. Mr. Speaker, we must continue to come together when it comes to sports development, because sports development is something that we all can benefit from. When Julian finally wins this Olympic medal, we will say St. Lucia won a medal. And so we mustn't play politics with things like Julian Alfred, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, young Naomi London, Mr. Speaker, is another prospect that we have in Beaufort North. Let's not play politics. Let's give her everything that we're supposed to, Mr. Speaker. As a minister, Mr. Speaker, I know I've tried from my part to ensure that everything that she needs. Sometimes there are delays, Mr. Speaker, and I get very disappointed. But if corporate St. Lucia decides to do their part as it pertains to this young girl and the others, we will go very far, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, youth development is something that I'm passionate about. I really don't know how else to describe someone who knows the truth, deliberately ignores the truth, comes into the house, makes statements as if, you know, he is shy from the truth, but knows the facts. The fact is, Mr. Speaker, we did launch the Skill 758 app, Mr. Speaker. We did launch this in March, Mr. Speaker, and we do have images that proved that the Ministry of Youth was in full attendance. We had some issues with the app, as with everything in technology. And so we had some glitches that we had to take care of. But the Skill 758 app is set to ensure that more people who are unemployed can find a one-stop shop to provide their CVs so that they can be geolocated for job opportunities. I was very happy to hear the Honorable Prime Minister announced that youth unemployment fell from 38.5% to 25.9%, Mr. Speaker. And so this app is supposed to help out with providing even more opportunities to young people. And so the fact is, during this government, during this administration's time, any young person who is ambitious, who is willing to work, who has any plan or design can get some assistance from the government, Mr. Speaker. This is the opportunity that we're providing for our people, Mr. Speaker. And so we continue to provide avenues for young people to speak. And so the ministry has the Crossroads program that could be viewed on NTN, where we interview the young people that are doing things in the communities, find out their experiences, and provide advice to other young people on how they can succeed, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the member looked at a document and saw zero, and he said, nothing is going on, Mr. Speaker. And I felt insulted on behalf of the young people of this ministry, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports, through the Western Cluster of Youth Workers, they embarked on an Adopt an Angel school feeding program. This program assisted in paying lunch fees for a few underprivileged students in Sufra, in Ancillary, and in Canaries. And Mr. Speaker, he comes to this Honorable House and says, nothing is going on in the Ministry of Youth. Mr. Speaker, he's always lying. Why is he lying? Sorry, Mr. Speaker. Let me apologize.
He's a stranger to the truth.
Why is he being disingenuous, Mr. Speaker? Why is he enjoying a daily diet of dishonesty, Mr. Speaker? Why, Mr. Speaker, must he indulge in verbal masturbation that provides pleasure to only himself, Mr. Speaker? Why, Mr. Speaker? Especially as it pertains to our young people.
To everything.
Especially, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, there's plenty going on in the Ministry of Youth, Mr. Speaker. Rosa Valley Business Information Workshop, Mr. Speaker. Job Fair in Sufra, Mr. Speaker. the youth business forum in Groseley. Young people, youth workers from the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports. Junior Jazz Festival is coming, Mr. Speaker. For the first time, Mr. Speaker, young persons in the art form, in collaboration, the member for Central Castries, the Mayor's Office, the Constituency Council, we are having, Mr. Speaker, Junior Jazz, Mr. Speaker.
18 countries.
And so, Mr. Speaker, the list goes on and on and on, Mr. Speaker. And so, this year, Commonwealth has indicated that 2023 will be designated as the Year of the Youth, Mr. Speaker. At the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting in Kigali in 2022, they sealed their commitments, the government sealed their commitments to this, Mr. Speaker. And Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to announce that the Ministry, in partnership with the Youth Council, they have committed to ensuring that another legacy emerges from this recognition of the Year of the Youth. And so, as opposed to just celebrating April, Mr. Speaker, we launched in April and we are going to enjoy a year of young activities throughout St. Lucia. Dance competitions, singing competitions, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, Youth Parliament, Mr. Speaker. And so we're going to continue to engage those young people for their ideas as to how it is that we can deal with this thing, Mr. Speaker. And so we've identified the issue of safety, security, and peace to empower young people and communities as agents of safe national coexistence. And so, Mr. Speaker, with USAID, Mr. Speaker, the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports collaborated on a YRE program, Mr. Speaker. YRE is a 5-year project that still strengthens communities and with family systems, initiatives to improve responses to gender-based violence, interpersonal violence, Mr. Speaker, and anything to do with violence. And so during Easter, Mr. Speaker, we're able to go to certain centers in St. Lucia, including Viewfort, to ensure that we start teaching self-control, Mr. Speaker, conflict management. This is done by the Ministry of Youth, Mr. Speaker. And so I won't tolerate anybody stating that the youth of this nation employed by the ministry is not working or nothing is going on, Mr. Speaker. So, Speaker, we are determined to uproot this culture of violence by building a safer and more resilient society as we struggle with this interpersonal crime and violence in St. Lucia, Mr. Speaker. And so we will do our part, work with the Ministry of National Security, any other ministry, to ensure that we curb this issue of crime. During this year, Mr. Speaker, we will be ensuring that we pass the Youth Policy and Action Plan, Mr. Speaker. And this is a huge document that will set the way for how we develop young people in our societies. So I'm very excited about that, Mr. Speaker. I'm very excited about how we move this, how this movement continues to grow. And so, very proud as the Minister of Youth Development and Sports. Mr. Speaker, while I do not want to steal the thunder from the Minister of the Youth Economy, the Honorable Prime Minister, but Mr. Speaker, the youth economy is another agency that the ministry continues to work with. We have a lot of persons walking into the ministry wanting information. And so, of course, the Skill 758 app is one area they can put their information, but we encourage persons get to Chaussee Road, tap into the website, make your applications as we continue to deal with youth unemployment, Mr. Speaker. And so the app, Mr. Speaker, will create a database of skills, open employment opportunities, open avenues for gig economy, Mr. Speaker, so they don't have to depend on government. Use your talent, boost the local economy, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, based on our discussions and dialogue with other businesses, Mr. Speaker, we are seeing more and more persons interested in helping out with youth development, Mr. Speaker. So, Speaker, the ministry has embarked on the Old Reunion School to convert it as a safe space, Mr. Speaker, the community of Chauzel, to help at the end of the day provide a building where young people can come and have a safe avenue to discuss, to have programs, and to develop each other, Mr. Speaker. All this, Mr. Speaker, is happening in the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the positive youth development paradigm is what underpins my ministry. This ministry values young people. We acknowledge that they are vital, and we'll continue to work with them, Mr. Speaker. And so, Mr. Speaker, I want to tell young people and the people of Grozily that I will continue to do all that I can to make their lives better. I've said this before. As the MP, I'm not going to hide for 3 years and then come back on the third and ask them for their support. I have made it my duty to be on the ground as much as I can possibly be, Mr. Speaker. By the bus stops, by the supermarkets, at their homes, at the barbecues, the funerals, Mr. Speaker.
You look like NCMA.
Everywhere that I need to be. Can everybody see me in 18 months? No. Have I been at every home in 18 months? No. Is that feasible? No. But we've held meetings in almost all of the communities, Mr. Speaker. We continue to engage people on matters as it pertains to infrastructure development, safety and security, youth development, sports, Mr. Speaker, in as many communities as possible. Very excited about the prospects of the Grand Riviere Community Center for this new financial year, Mr. Speaker. Very excited about the developments around the playing field, Mr. Speaker. Developments in Asu Canal, Mr. Speaker, in Piat, in Monsepa, in Monye, Mr. Speaker. I'm very, very buoyed by some of the pronouncements made by the Prime Minister, including Novat on cement and some of these construction supplies, because we need it, Mr. Speaker. We need it for Fair Helen to rise, Mr. Speaker. Grozily Town continues to have full consideration in development of the park, the playing field stands, Mr. Speaker. And so, I'm not going to say much because the member for Atsuri Kadris is stated by, I know why he's stated by direction, but we'll continue to ensure that we do what we need to do, Mr. Speaker. I'm very excited about Moshi Jazz, the return of Moshi Jazz, Mr. Speaker. This is a fringe event, Mr. Speaker, that brings scores of individuals, and it's absolutely free, Mr. Speaker. And so we invite everybody on May 9th to come to the community, Mr. Speaker, and enjoy the ambience, Mr. Speaker, of our people. The lights are coming, Mr. Speaker, on the Moshi playing field. And so I take this opportunity to thank all individuals and agencies that contributed to youth and sports development within the last year, including but not limited to youth workers, youth officers, youth leaders, youth and sports councils, physical education teachers, coaches, principals, national sports associations, schools, the Ministry of Education, club members, administrators, fans, everyone involved in youth and sports development. I want to call upon all St. Lucians not just to support sports and youth development, not only those in the sporting fraternity, but I want to invite everybody to do their part. Sports development remains a viable option for our young people to attain their true potential in improving their lives and that of their families. Mr. Speaker, in fact, Mr. Deputy Speaker, so my apologies, we are not a perfect ministry. We are not a perfect government. Can we do more? Yes, we can, and we will. Let me thank the staff of the ministry for all their hard work, particularly the Permanent Secretary, Caroline Eugene, Deputy Permanent Secretary, Mrs. Mary Wilfred, Director of Sports, Jim Xavier, and of course, our new Director of Youth, Ruan Lubo. The Ministry of Youth and Sports continues to work towards securing a better future for our young people. As a result, I have no issues with supporting this appropriation bill for the financial year 2023-2024. It is my belief that Helen has risen and will continue to run in the right direction. I thank you, Mr. Speaker.